Yes guys, turn to the sixth one. Read through the question. Asta acquired 80% of both classes of shares in Birat Limited on 1/4/2007. The draft balance sheet of two companies is given to you. Asta and Birat, two companies' balance sheets as on 31st March 08, that is at the end of the financial year. Equity shares, preference shares, general reserve. Now this is the first time that we are looking at a preference share in the in the subsidiary company. Check, Birat is a subsidiary. It has 14% preference shares as far as the company is concerned. So how do you do when I have a preference share in this subsidiary? So preference shares in subsidiary. Very simple calculation, guys. Whenever you have preference shares, these preference share capital should be divided into two parts. A portion which can be held by holding, not necessary at all, because it does not give you any voting power. A holding company can only hold equity shares also without holding even one preference share. No problem, it will still be called as a holding company. And the rest of the preference shares are held by others. I cannot call it as minority now. I'll call them as others because there is no minority or a majority as far as preference shares is concerned. We have a equity shares because they have voting power. We have majority and minority. Here I'll call it as if there is anything held by holding or they are held by others. To the extent they are held by holding company, this we will treat it in cost of control. Whatever preference shares are held by others, we will add it to minority interest. Now this, how do you treat it in the cost of control? In the cost of control, normally what do we compare? We compare cost of investments less pre-acquisition dividend if they have received any, this I'll compare it with share in net assets. By virtue of the preference shares, I don't get any share in the reserves. What I get is only a share capital. So when I take share in net assets, I'll only take share in preference share capital. That's it. So share in preference share capital. Compare this amount. And this will give you either goodwill or capital reserve. Now a goodwill or capital reserve from equity shares, a goodwill or capital reserve from preference shares, both can be combined. Both can be on a combined basis. If I have both goodwills, I'll add both. If I have a goodwill and a capital reserve, I'll try to get the net figure. So, but still, we have to calculate the goodwill or capital reserve for the preference shares as well. Now, can I combine it and solve? No problem. You can combine equity shares and preference shares when you write cost of investment and when you write net share of net assets, you can add the equity share capital and preference share capital and show it as your share in net assets. Either you maintain one single column or maintain two columns, one for equity shares, one for preference shares. Whatever you do, ultimately towards the end, whenever you get goodwill or capital reserve, you need to add it or net it. Whatever it is, it should be presented on a combined basis. When you have to add it to minority interest, simple. Like how you start with minority interest, share in share capital. That share in share capital need not be only equity. It can be even preference also. So those part of preference shares which are not held by the holding company, these are held by others, will directly add it to the value of minority interest there. So, take down this calculation. The simple adjustment as far as the preference dividend is concerned. So, preference share capital is concerned. Yes, guys, let's continue reading that question. Problem number 6. 14% preference shares are there in a company and I have a P&L account and a creditors existing. On the asset side, check your investments. Investments in equity shares is 1920 and in preference shares is 320. So, the holding company also holds preference shares in the subsidiary. But not the entire one, only to the extent of 320. So, we have other preference shares which should be added to minority interest. In the additional information, he says, general reserve of Birat was the same as it was in 1407. Come to the general reserve. General reserve in Birat Limited was 40. It is the same value what was existing on the date of acquisition as well. That means during the current year, there was no appropriation to general reserve. So there is no point of analyzing it. If you analyze also, what do we say? Balance as on 31st March 2008 is 40. Balance existing on 1407 is 40, which is pre-acquisition. Post-acquisition is perfect zero. So let's try to avoid those working notes which are unnecessary. Come to the next point. The balance in P&L of Birat Limited on 1407 was 320,000, out of which dividend at the rate of 16% per annum on the equity share capital of 6 lakhs was paid during the year 2006-07. So during the year 2006-07, he is paying the dividend later on, and such dividend is paid out of profits existing on 1407, that is out of pre-acquisition profits. So such a dividend will be called as pre-acquisition dividend for us. Dividend in respect of preference shares for the year 2007-08 was still payable on 31st March 2008. Asha credited its P&L account with the dividend received from Birat for the year 2006-07. His date of acquisition is 1407. So whatever dividend he received for the year 2006-07 entirely should be pre-acquisition dividend. But it has been wrongly credited to P&L. So again the similar adjustment what we have been seeing throughout. Sundry creditors of Asta Limited included an amount of 120,000 for purchases from Birat, on which the later company made a loss of 10,000. So not always unrealized profit, we sometimes get unrealized loss as well. If it was an unrealized profit, we deducted it. Now since it is an unrealized loss, we add it. Half of the goods are still lying in the closing stock as on 31st March. So half goods are already sold out. So my unrealized profit is not entire 10,000. My unrealized loss is only 5,000. Only to the extent of stock which is remaining in the closing stock. So what is remaining in the closing stock is only half of the goods. So 5,000 is unrealized loss which should be added to the profit. Now, is it an upstream or downstream transaction? Read through the transaction again and check. Creditors of Asta included goods purchased from Birat. What? Purchased from Birat. Who is Birat? Birat is a subsidiary company. So, Asta is purchasing from Birat. Holding is buying from the subsidiary. It is an upstream transaction. At the time of acquisition of Asta Limited, while determining the price of the shares of Birat Limited, it was considered that the value of plant and machinery should be increased by 25% and that of furniture and fixtures should be reduced to 80%. There is no transaction of sale or purchase during the year. Directors wish to give such revaluations in the consolidated balance sheet. So again, a case of revaluation reserves. The directors of Asta were of an opinion that the disclosure of its contingent liability will seriously prejudice the company's position in dispute to the contractor. So there's a contingent liability, we need to even deal with that. Prepare a consolidated balance sheet as on 31st March 2008, assuming that the rate of depreciation charged is 25% per annum and 10% per annum on plant and machinery and furniture and fixture respectively. Workings forming part of your answer. So there are not many adjustments because general reserve I don't have to analyze at all. So there's one more reserve there, which is a P&L account. So we need to analyze the P&L. We also need to analyze for revaluation reserve. So two reserves which has to be analyzed in your step 3. So start with your step 1, that is your date of acquisition. Date of acquisition is 1407. shareholding pattern. There's no bonus treatment which is coming up here. So directly I can put it as number of shares held. And percentage holding. So held by Astha Limited and held by minority interest or minority. Check how many shares are held by Astha. He has acquired 80% of both classes of shares. So 80% of both classes of shares, my shareholding pattern I'm only giving with respect to equity shares. So if this is 100% holding, 80% is held by Astha, 20% is held by minority. I have the total number of shares in Virat. Everything is given in thousands. Take in thousands. Virat, 600,000 is your share capital. Each share is 10 rupees. So I can say this is 60. So 80% is 48 and 20% is 12. I need not write preference, guys. Equity is sufficient. That is what gives me the shareholding pattern or majority interest. Start with the step 3. Analysis of reserves. Analysis of reserves of Virat with respect to date of acquisition. That is 1407. Check. The first thing we have to do is always revaluation reserve, because there will be a depreciation on revaluation which we have to adjust against the P&L. So unless we identify what is the revaluation reserve, we cannot identify what is the depreciation impact on revaluation. A revaluation is given in point number 7. Read through carefully and that will be the first reserve for us to analyze. I have two revaluations here. Read the point number 7. At the time of acquisition, while determining the price of the shares in Virat Limited, it was considered that the value of the plant and machinery should be increased by 25 and furniture and fixtures should be reduced to 80%. So two assets, one is plant and machinery and one is furniture. Maintain two columns and let's start solving. When is he revaluing? On the date of acquisition. What was the date of acquisition? 1407. But I don't have the book value on 1407. I have book values on 31st March 08. That is after 1 year. What was the book value? Plant and machinery is 600 and furniture is 540. Start with the given information. Book value as on 31st March 2008. Plant and machinery is 600. Furniture and fixture is 540. Now, come down to the last para. After the point number 8. Assume that the rate of depreciation charge is 25% per annum on plant and machinery and 10% per annum on furniture and fixture. If I have to get the book value on 1407, I need to add back the amount of depreciation which was already charged. I can't take, if plant and machinery, he said it is 25%. I can't take 25% of 600. This 600 is after reducing 25%. That means this is 75. We need to add back 25 is 75 so that we get what is the book value on 1407. So we need to do the reverse calculation. So to identify the book value, as on 1407, understand in simple terms, if I have a book value of asset, you don't have to write this, guys, book value of an asset on 1407, let's say it was 100, So minus depreciation during the current year at the rate of 25%, I would have charged 25 on this. So what will be the book value as on 31st March 08? It would have been 75. So this 75 is 600. I need to get this 100. How do we calculate? Show the calculation. 600 into 100 divided by 75. This is 800. Similar way, come to the furniture. Furniture, how much is depreciated? 10%. So if 100 rupee was the furniture value as on 1/4, 10 rupees depreciation was charged, and the book value as on 31st March 2008 was 90. So you know 90. All you need to get is 100. How do you get 100? 540 into 100 divided by 90. This is 600. Now you got the book values as on the date of revaluation, that is 1407. Once you know the date of revaluation and you have the values, the book values, start identifying the revaluation reserve, compare it with the revaluation reserve. Compare it with the information given, check. You have to increase your plant and machinery by 25 and reduce your furnitures to 80. 280 in the sense, reduction is 20%. So plant and machinery upward revalued, furniture downward revalued. So upward revaluation as far as your plant and machinery is concerned, upward by 25%, 25% of 800 depreciation, sorry, your revaluation reserve should be 200. This is down to 80 in the sense it is a negative 20%, 120. 20% on 600 and 25% on 800. Furniture is downward revaluation. I'm showing it in brackets. This is an upward revaluation. Show it in a positive figure. So my net revaluation reserve is 80. And like we always know, revaluation reserve is pre-acquisition reserves. Since the revaluation was done on the date of acquisition, always the revaluation reserve should be considered as pre-acquisition. You need not go for the analysis of general reserve, guys. General reserve, anyways, direct 40 is pre-acquisition reserve only. So what we need to do is now P&L. Check the P&L in the balance sheet. I can see P&L in the Birat Limited balance sheet for 720. Start with that figure. Put on a heading P&L. Balance as on 31st March 08 is 720. Split. My balance as on 1407. On the date of acquisition. You can read through. Point number 2. The balance of P&L in Birat Limited on 1407, that was the date of acquisition, was 3,20,000. I am writing everything in thousands. So this will be written as 320. However, there is an adjustment from this. Out of which, that means from this 320, they have paid 16% dividend on equity shares of 6 lakhs for the period 2006-07. Now, the question remains, what about preference dividend then? There should be a question regarding preference dividend. If I have to pay to the equity shareholders equity dividend, compulsory rule is that I need to pay my preference shareholders as well, which has become a compulsion. Yes. So unless and until I pay the preference dividend, I cannot pay this equity dividend part of it. The question never talks about preference dividend because he assumes that you, so he at least expects that you assume it. You have to assume it, that how can he pay equity dividend without even paying the preference dividend part of it. So first pay preference dividend, then pay equity dividend. Without paying the preference dividend, I am not supposed to pay the equity dividend at all. Check the preference dividend. There are 14% preference shares of 400. So less dividend of 2006-07, last year's dividend, get a preference dividend first. ...14% preference dividend on preference share capital of 400. 56. And then equity dividend. My amount of equity dividend is calculated at the rate of 16% on 6 lakhs in 1000, that is 600. This is 96. These are the dividends for the last year. And the resultant figure is 168. So if this is 168, then I can calculate what is my current year profits. Calculate current year profits. Current year profits is 552. That is nothing but 720 minus 168 rupees of dividend which is already provided. Now come to the adjustments. Take each adjustment. Guys, I hope you got the 552. 720 is the total profit. 168 is the opening profit. Current year profits is 552. Now come to the adjustments. One by one, let's consider. Guys, in the point number 4, he is saying whatever dividend was received has been credited to P&L by Astha Limited. He gets a 80% in the preference dividend. He gets 80% in equity dividend. Both considered in P&L. Both are wrong treatments. Because both are pertaining to pre-acquisition dividend of the previous year. He acquired on 1407. That is a previous year for him. A dividend received for a year when he was not even the shareholder of it. We call it as pre-acquisition dividend and we consider it in cost of control. Yes. Continue. Now the first adjustment that I can see there is your unrealized loss. Sundry creditors of Astha Limited included an amount of 1,20,000 for purchases from Virat Limited on which the latter company made a loss of 10,000. Half the goods were still lying in the closing stock of Astha Limited. It is in the closing stock of holding company. That means subsidiary sold to the holding. Subsidiary sold to the holding, subsidiary incurred a loss. Loss incurred is actually 10, but half the goods are already sold out by the holding company. Remaining half we have to consider it as unrealized loss. Unrealized loss on stock. 50% of 10,000 rupee loss. I'm writing everything in 1000, so I'll add 5. Unrealized profit would have been deducted. Unrealized loss add. Because the loss has already reduced my P&L. Now I need to increase the P&L to the extent of unrealized loss. Now coming to the depreciation and revaluations. My depreciation and revaluation, two impacts. One is plant and machinery and furniture. Plant and machinery, depreciation percentage is 25 on 200 revaluation. Furniture is 10% of 120. Plant and machinery upward revalued. So depreciation will increase, profit should reduce to the extent of 50. And this one add 12 because downward revaluation. There's one more adjustment which is hidden. which you can't see here in anywhere in the question, but which has to be compulsorily provided whenever I have sufficient profits, preference dividend of the current year. This is last year's preference dividend of 2006-07. What about 7-8 dividend? He neither proposed, he neither paid. But understand, preference dividend is compulsory to be paid in the case of sufficient profits. So I have sufficient profits here, so I need to compulsorily deduct a preference dividend. No equity dividend, guys. Equity dividend should be compulsorily proposed for you to deduct. So preference dividend for the year 2007-08. I'll get the same amount of dividend, so I don't have to calculate again. 56. So total 3 adjustments, unrealized profit on stock. Where is the second adjustment then? So this 5 I have added up here. I'll also add in consolidated balance sheet. I'll increase stock by 5. Depreciation on revaluation, I'll reduce plant and machinery in your consolidated balance sheet by 50. I'll increase furniture by 12 in the consolidated balance sheet. Preference dividend, I'll come to this treatment. This 56 rupees of preference dividend which is being proposed today for the year 2007-08, it is unpaid. To the extent it is unpaid, I need to give a special treatment for it. So check what is the balance here. How much? 463 it says, so this is pre-acquisition and 463 is post-acquisition. You have identified pre-acquisition, you have identified post-acquisition, you need to go for distribution of reserves. Don't hurry when you put the distribution of table. Remember, how many of our post-acquisition reserves are there? Those many columns I need. Revaluation reserve is completely pre. General reserve, completely pre. It was P&L, the only reserve which had a post-acquisition reserve. So post-acquisition reserve will have only one column. I did not analyze general reserve. First take up the general reserve in the distribution table. Check general reserve 40. The entire 40 will be treated as pre-acquisition. Then come to the revaluation reserve. 80. Check your analysis of reserves and post it. And the last one is P&L, 168 pre and 463 post. $288 and $460 is the total provisions. Asta Limited will get 80% of the reserves and the minority will get 20% of the reserve. This is 57.6 and this is 230.4. This is 92.6 and this is 370.4. We have the distribution table, very small guys. Now, think about the preference dividend for 2007-08 which is proposed and not paid. Out of this preference dividend of 56, which was proposed for the year 2007-8, I have two parts. One which belongs to a holding company, that is ASTA, to the extent of 80%, and 20% which belongs to minority. So, think from ASTA's perspective, this 80% dividend he did not receive. It is a dividend receivable for him. So, whenever it is a dividend receivable, I need to increase in the reserves for CBS. So, I have reduced here. I need to have two counter impacts. The first counter impact is 80% of this 56 should be added into the reserves of ASTA in your step number 7, where you discuss about reserves for CBS. Then what about the balance 20? Balance 20 belongs to minority interest. Did I pay? I did not pay. It is still a liability. So I'll increase it in minority interest. But if such preference dividend, if he said it is already paid, if it is already paid, then I don't have to give any particular adjustment at all. But since here it is not paid, I'm splitting it into two parts. One is a holding company's portion, which I'm adding to the reserves for CBS, since it is a post-acquisition dividend for him. And second part, minority interest 20% will be added to the minority interest in your step number 6. Go on. Step number 5 and 6. Cost of control. Minority interest. And then go for your reserves for CBS as well. My cost of control, let me split into two parts. In equity shares and in preference shares. You can combine it and solve, I don't mind. Start with cost of investments. Less pre-acquisition dividend. What is the cost of investment check? In equity shares it is 1920 and in preference share it is 320. Check your balance sheet asset side. Investments are 1920 in equity shares and 320 for preference shares. Pre-acquisition dividend. When did he purchase? 1407. So whatever dividend is paid for the year 2006-7, when he was not a shareholder, the entire dividend should be treated as pre-acquisition dividend, where he received these two dividends for the year 2006-7, but he has credited it wrongly to your P&L account. Now we need to adjust it. How much is the shareholding? He acquired 80% in both classes of shares. So, 80% of preference dividend and 80% of equity dividend, both will be your pre-acquisition dividends. Pre-acquisition dividend for equity shares 96 into 80%, and this is 56 into 80%. This is 76.8. And this will give me 1843.2 and 275.2. Check. Compare this with share and net assets. Of Birat with respect to the date of acquisition. This has to be split between share capital and pre-acquisition reserves. Equity share capital he holds 80%. 48 shares. 48 shares, each share of 10 rupees, 480. Equity part. Preference part. My preference shares are 400. 80% he holds, 320. I will not have pre-acquisition reserves for preference. But for equity, I have to post 230.4. My total share in net assets will be 710.4 and 320. First case is goodwill. And second case is a capital reserve. On a net basis, I have a goodwill of 1088. You have a goodwill of 1088 on a net basis. Yes guys, then come to the minority interest. Share and share capital. After include two share capitals, one is equity share capital and one is preference share capital. My equity share capital is 12 shares, each share of 10 rupees, 120. Preference shares, total 400, 20% held, 80. His share in the reserves. Pre-acquisition and post-acquisition reserves. Distribution table 57.6 and 92.6. These are the share in the reserves. Normally would have ended it here, but I have an additional here. First type of question where we are getting preference dividend payable. Be it any dividend, be it preference or equity, whenever there is a dividend payable, we have seen in the dividend adjustments at the beginning that we need to include minority interest part in the minority interest. Preference dividend, they hold 20%. So 20% of the preference dividend of 56 this year is 78, not 67. 67 dividend is already paid. Already paid liability is settled. So what is not paid is only 78, which we need to add it for 11.2. This is 361.4. Then go for reserves for CBS, the final working note before the balance sheet. Guys, though there is two reserves in your balance sheet, in the balance sheet of A Limited, general reserve and P&L, I don't need to maintain two columns. The reason is, general reserve does not have any adjustments. General reserve in the consolidated balance sheet will be also exactly 1900. Because there is no post-acquisition general reserve which is being taken over from Birata. So the same 1900 as it is will appear. I would have maintained the general reserve column had it been a case that there is a post-acquisition general reserve in Birata Limited, that is a subsidiary. Because we'll say that the share in post-acquisition general reserve of Birata Limited should also be added to the general reserve of Astha. But here, I don't have such situation. Entire general reserve, we put it under pre-acquisition reserves. So, only one column is required, that is your amount of P&L. Always start with balance in Astha Limited. Balance in Astha Limited, check Astha Limited balance of P&L is 1600. Keep it simple initially, add share in net assets, share in post acquisition reserves of Birata. What is the share in post acquisition reserves of Birata? Post acquisition reserves of Birata share is 370.4. Less pre-acquisition dividend. For which year I'm talking about? 6-7. Wrongly credited to P&L. That anyways we have adjusted it to cost of control. You don't have to calculate again. Check your cost of control. 76.8 equity dividend and 44.8 is preference dividend. Add both 76.8 plus 44.8. The total is 121.6. Already included in P&L. Now you deduct it. One more adjustment is remaining. That is regarding this preference dividend of 2007-8. 7-8 preference dividend, if Birata has announced, then I hold 80% being Astha. So I need to receive 80, that is a dividend income for me, completely post-acquisition. So write it as preference dividend receivable. For the year 2007-8. Entire thing is post acquisition guys, because you have acquired on 1407. How do you calculate 56 into 80%? We have already calculated that. That is 44.8. Strike a total. Now come to the 8th adjustment. Directors of Astha Limited are of an opinion that the disclosure of its contingent liability will seriously prejudice the company's position in dispute with the contractor. So he is saying that there is a contingent liability which are for the damages claimed by the contractors to the extent of 155. And the director have disclosed it as contingent liability. He does not want to disclose it as a part of books of accounts or in the balance sheet, since it will seriously affect the balance sheet, seriously prejudice the condition of the balance sheet. So, but still, that cannot be called as a tenable claim under AS according to the accounting standard number 4. AS 4, which deals with contingency, says that whenever there is a probability of occurrence which is remote, then I need not show. But if it is probable, then definitely I'll show it as a contingent liability. But if it is likely to occur, then I have to maintain a provision. Now very clearly it indicates that there is a likely situation that a contingent liability will definitely crystallize as a total liability. So for this adjustment, we need to maintain a provision. It is not a liability today. It is only a provision that we maintain today. It is a provision for an expected loss in the future, which we maintain with respect to AS4, AS29, with underlying concept of your conservatism. Your conservatism is the underlying concept saying that expected future losses should be provided for. But we also use the standard 4 and 29 and we say that compulsory a provision should be created. When you create a provision, the entry is P&L account debit to provision. So when I'm debiting P&L, what is happening? My profits are automatically reducing. So to this extent here, add an additional condition point number E, put a star mark there so that you understand this adjustment separately and write it as provision for damages claimed by contractor . I'm writing everything in thousands, so this one also in thousands. So it is 1738.6 is your reserve to be reported in your balance sheet. In the balance sheet of consolidation, after the consolidation, you'll also see under current liabilities a provision for 155 amount which is appearing there. So we can start for the consolidated balance sheet if you're completing with all the adjustments. for the consolidated balance sheet of Astha Limited as on 31st March 2008. Start with equity and liabilities. Shareholder funds. Share capital. Under share capital, we have equity share capital of 3000. We also have reserves and surplus. There's no capital reserve when we did your cost of control. So the reserve is a general reserve of 1900 as it is what appeared in the balance sheet of Astha and the P&L, which we just changed to 1738.4. A separate line item to the extent of minority interest. We have already calculated this to 361.4. My non-current liabilities are nil. And finally, current liabilities . The first of the current liability is creditors. Simple addition. There's no intercompany owings which he's talking about, I guess. Is there? Yes, there is. Creditors of Astha Limited included an amount of 1,20,000 for purchases. So reduce 120 from both debtors as well as creditors. So my creditors will become 500 now. 300 plus 320 minus 120. And do not forget this provision which we just created. Provision for damages. 155. I'll give us the end of balance sheet on the liability side and then come to the assets. For my assets, I have a non-current assets. And for non-current assets, I have tangible fixed assets. Under tangible fixed assets, let's check. The first one is plant and machinery. How do we calculate plant and machinery? 2060 plus 600. Plus 200 is the upward revaluation, 50 depreciation on revaluation, so this will become 2810. I have added the balance sheet figures of 2060 and 600. 200 was the upward revaluation in plant and machinery, 50 was the extra depreciation that you need to charge for the year 2007-8. Then come to the furniture part of it. 600 plus 540, balance sheet values, downward revalued by 120, add 12 rupees of depreciation added back. Then I have intangible assets. Only one intangible asset, that is the amount of goodwill. Check your cost of control, 1088. Your investments get cancelled off, so there's no other non-current assets. Other non-current assets is nil. Come to the current assets now. The first current asset is stock. Stock value is 680 plus 404. Plus 5. Unrealized profit was deducted. Unrealized loss should be added back. 1289 is the stock. Debtors, reduce it by 120 again. Oh, your debtors. Debtors, reduce it by 120. 120 reduced, so you get 756, I guess. Then your cash and bank balances, a simple addition, there's no change. 660 plus 220 is 6. So, yes guys, let's start question number 7. The summarized balance sheet of a subsidiary B Limited is given to you. 2010 and 2011, two comparative years, is drafting the balance sheet for you. Consider the following information. B Limited is a subsidiary of A Limited and both followed a calendar year for accounting purposes. A Limited values stock on LIFO basis while B Limited used FIFO basis. To bring B Limited stock in line with A Limited stock, it is required to reduce 12,000 at the end of 2010 and 34,000 at the end of 2011. Both the companies use a straight line method of depreciation, however, A charges depreciation at the rate of 10%. B deducted 1% from the debtors as a general provision against doubtful debts. Prepaid expenditure in B Limited include advertisement expenditure carried forward 60,000 in 2010, 30,000 in 2011, being a part of initial advertisement expenditure of 90,000 in 2010, which is written off over 3 years. Similar amount in A Limited was fully written off in 2010 itself. Restate the balance sheet of B Limited as on 31st March after considering the above information for the purpose of consolidation. Now, the question arises, why did he specifically say both are following calendar year? Can't I consolidate when both the years are not the same? Let's say subsidiary is closing its balance sheet on 31st December, holding closing its balance sheet on 31st March. Can I consolidate? Question arises. These are the questions which normally arise. Second question. Someone for the holding is company is following is a different accounting policy. Subsidiary follows a different accounting policy. Can I consolidate now? Again creates a problem. Now, this is a situation which we have to resolve in this problem number 15. So, write down first. The first note. For the purpose of consolidation, difference between the balance sheet date of holding and subsidiary should not be more than 6 months. Should not be more than 6 months. Instead of reading the point as it is, apply some mind to it. I cannot have two dates which are separated by more than 6 months. I am clearly saying that I cannot have two dates which are separated by more than 6 months. There is no chance for it. Now, how did I say that? Understand. Let's say in the holding company's balance sheet, let's say the subsidiary's balance sheet date is on 31st December 2014. Holding company is on 31st March 2015. Possible, because the difference is only 3 months. Pull it behind. This is 31st October 2014. Holding company is on 31st March 2015. Possible. 6 months, possible. Put it more behind. This is 30th June 2014. Keep holding constant at 31st March 2015. Not possible. No problem. You consolidate with 31st March 2014. Why? Observe. Again, the difference is only 3 months. So, you give any two dates, the difference between two balance sheet dates cannot be more than 6 months. If it is not closer to 31st March 2015, it should be closer to 31st March 2014 or 2016. There can never be a situation or a scenario which arises that the difference is more than 6 months. Then why did he give this point? Was it even necessary for me to give? It was necessary. It was necessary because if this point was not there, I would have consolidated with 31st March 2015, recording a difference of 9 months. Recording a difference of 9 months. And during 9 months, there could be a material differences what might have happened, which are necessary to be reported, which won't get reported in the subsidiary balance sheet at all. That is the reason why I am restricting myself to a maximum of 6 months. So if I consolidate with 31st March 2014, the difference will be only maximum 3 months. Got it? So this is what he is meaning by this. But if suppose there are some changes which happen. Let us say this case. Difference between these two dates was 6 months. After the subsidiary limited balance sheet was closed on 31st October, let's say there was plenty of material changes which happened there. If plenty of material changes have happened, then definitely what he'll say, such material changes should be disclosed. So, material changes between the balance sheet date and the consolidation and the consolidated balance sheet date should be reported in notes to accounts. And also we have an extension to your financial statements which read as statement of changes in equity, which is also a separate standard which we'll which we have in IND-AS, where we also disclose the material changes in equity. Earlier we had section 212 of Companies Act. This was 1956 Companies Act, which is not there anymore. Okay, earlier we had a section 212 where there were the statement prepared for all the material changes which happened between the balance sheet date and the consolidation date, and we stated all those differences in section 212. Now there is no statement as such, but it is an extension to the financial statements, and also an IFR, we have an IFRS and an IND-AS dealing with it. We will discuss about that later on. We don't have to deal with that in consolidation at all. So take down this part. Yes, guys. Then, subsequently, when we were talking about accounting policy, I said there can be a difference of accounting policies between a holding and subsidiary. Then, if there is a difference, then what should we do? Whenever I have a difference in accounting policy, does it mean that a subsidiary has to prepare its accounting policies in line with the holding company? Not necessary. Subsidiary can have its own accounting policies because it is not necessary that both are thriving in the same industry. Selection of accounting policy is basically a matter of management judgment. And the management judgment should also be decided by presenting a true and fair view, substance over form, materiality and your prudence concept. Three concepts which are very much necessary for you to decide upon what is an accounting policy for a business. Materiality changes from person to person, industry to industry and company to company. You cannot say that a same particular accounting policy should be applied for both holding as well as subsidiary. That is not possible. So the first thing to clarify is, subsidiary can follow a different set of accounting policies distinct from policies of holding company, but for limited purpose of consolidation, for the limited purpose of consolidation, accounting policies have to be realigned and the balance sheet needs to be redrafted for the subsidiary company. That means, if a subsidiary maintains a separate set of accounting policies that are distinct from the holding company, you can follow. But whenever I have to consolidate, the accounting policies which are followed by the subsidiary should be harmonized with the holding company, and you have to redraft the balance sheet of the subsidiary and then you can consolidate. Without redrafting the accounting policies of, without redrafting the balance sheet according to the accounting policies of holding, you cannot consolidate. A fixed asset which is valued at SLM, a fixed asset which is valued at WDV, I cannot add. They have to be made uniform. So, copy down this. Yes, guys, so let's solve this problem number 15, a small problem. Consider the following summarized balance sheets of a subsidiary B Limited. We have to redraft these two balance sheets now. To redraft the balance sheets, first, let's think about the adjustment to profit. Automatically, we'll get the other adjustments. So, we need to restate the P&L as on 31st December 2011. But to get the 2011 profits, I also need to adjust 2010 profits because that will give you the opening figure. So, put on heading restated P&L of B Limited. Restated P&L of B I need to restate for both 2010 as well as 2011. First start with opening balance. 2010 balance is 2,86,000, which needs to be adjusted. Then I will take it as 2011 opening balance. First adjusted. Adjustments are really necessary now. Let's see. The first adjustment, I'll come line by line. Second B point, adjustment for stock. Adjustment for first point, stock. A Limited values stock on LIFO and B Limited values on FIFO. Where B Limited values in line with those of A Limited, its stock value should be reduced by 12,000 in 2010, 34,000 in 2011. Now what he is talking about is a closing stock. If there is an adjustment in the closing stock, it should also adjust the next year's opening stock as well. So my stock adjustments I'll split into two parts. One is the closing stock. Other one is opening stock. Check the closing stock adjustment now. Closing stock should be reduced by 12,000 in 2010. Stock reduces, profit also reduces. 34,000 in 2011. But come to the opening stock. This 12,000 of 2010 closing stock should become 2011 opening stock. So if opening stock reduces, profit increases. Always you'll have a reverse impact for this. If I would have a next year, 2012, 34,000, I'll increase the P&L in the next year. Always you need to keep moving forward. Next, second one. Both the companies did SLM basis, but A depreciated at 10%. Check B. What is the depreciation charge? Depreciation charge, don't take it as 48,000 and 3,20,000. Observe the difference between 2 years. The increase in depreciation between 2010 and 2011 is 48 with a book value of 3,20,000. That means its depreciation percentage is being 15. So additionally 5% depreciation is being charged. It is just a coincidence that directly you can check from the first year. Okay, but you can't check it that way. The first year accumulated depreciation can include 3-4 years also. So don't necessarily compare this 48,000 and 3,20,000. Compare the addition to depreciation. 2010 accumulated depreciation was 48. 2011 accumulated depreciation is 96. That means there is an increase of 48,000 for depreciation during the year on 3,20,000 of an asset having a 15% depreciation, so additional depreciation of 5%. Now he extra charged 5%, so my P&L is reduced. Now I have to increase it. So second one is depreciation adjustment. $16,000. Add back to both years. Next come to point number See, B deducts 1% from the sundry debtors as a general provision against doubtful debts, which is not there as per A. That means my debtors which you see in the balance sheet of B, they are only 99%. They have been reduced by 1% where a general provision was created against the doubtful debts. So you need to add that back. Provision for doubtful debts. Check. What was the provision maintained in 2010? If 5,94,000 is the value of debtors of 99%, then what is 1? 5,94,000 into 1 by 99. 1 by 99 is 6,000. I'm adding it here. Come to the next year. 8,91,000 into 1 by 99 is 9,000. 6,000 already provision existing. Closing provision became 9. So I can't write 9,000 here. Not possible here. What we need to add is only 3,000. Because already an existing 6,000 provision is there. Now come to the last adjustment for prepaid expenses. Prepaid expenses. What is he talking about? Prepaid expenditure of B Limited includes 60,000 of 2010, 30,000 in 2011, some advertisement expenditure of 90,000 incurred in 2010, which was written off over 3 years. When did he incur? 2010. So how much did he write off? 2010, 30,000 he wrote off. 2011, 30,000 he wrote off. Planning to write off 2011, 2012 also 30,000 rupees. 90,000 is split into 3 parts. But he is saying, similar advertisement expenditure was completely written off in the same year, that is 2010. How much did you deduct in 2010? 30. How much you should have deducted in 2010? 90. That means, I have to deduct 60,000 from 2010. Since you did not deduct this, next year again I deducted 30. Which should not have been deducted. So next year 30,000 add. Simple logical understanding guys. 30,000 was already written off. Total expenditure was 90. If I have to completely write off, 30 already written off. So what I have to write off is only 60. If I completely write off in 2010, I will not have anything to be written off in 2011. So 2011, whatever you wrote of 30,000, you need to add it back to the profit. Once again guys, don't strike a line. Last one, net profit of 2011 is there, which we did not add. Then we'll get the profit to be taken. 2011 net profit, if you have to check, you need to compare between both the reserves. One is 7,40,000 in the closing, 2,86,000 at the beginning. 7,14,000 minus 2,86,000. This will give you the profit of 2011. This is 4,28,000. Once you get the balance here, which will be placed again in 2011 as an opening figure. Get the balance here. 2,36,000. Check the closing balances guys. Closing of 2011 should become opening of 2010 is opening of 2011. And the closing balance sheet finally in 2011 is 6,91,000. Check. Confirm the answer. The question is not this, it is asking you to restate the balance sheet. Now start restating the balance sheet. I want Schedule 3 again. When you're drafting the balance sheet, guys, it's not a consolidated balance sheet, it's just balance sheet of B. As on 31st December 2011, brackets write down restated. It's a restated balance sheet, guys. We have restated the accounting policies of B Limited in line with that of A Limited. Start with equity and liabilities. First one is shareholder funds. Under shareholder funds, share capital. Share capital is 5 lakhs. Then I have reserves restated to 6,91,000. I've just got that figure. Non-current liabilities are nil. I have my current liabilities here. Current liabilities are creditors 4,94,000, bank OD 1,70,000, and finally provision for tax 4,30,000. I hope you people are not consolidating. Both are same balance sheets only. B Limited, last year and current year. You can add both. Assets. Non-current assets. First one is tangible fixed assets. Check the value of tangible fixed assets there. Right now it is 2,24,000. But this 2,24,000 of tangible fixed assets, we added back depreciations of 16,000 and 16,000 over 2 years. So I need to add it by 32,000. 2,56,000 as fixed assets. There is no intangible asset, but there is a non-investment, other non-current assets. Intangible assets is nil. Other non-current assets. Under other non-current assets, I have investments. Value of 4 lakhs. There's no change to that value. From here, almost every balance has changed. Come to the figures of current assets now. First current asset of stock. stock, closing stock should be reduced by 34,000. Right now it is 7,42,000, closing stock down by 34, so my stock balance will be only 7,08,000. Debtors, add it with the amount of provision, 6,000 plus 3,000, closing provision is 9,000. Add the closing provision to debtors, you will have a debtor of 9 lakhs. Prepaid expenses. One adjustment is there for prepaid expenses. That 48,000 down below, he said the prepaid expense include advertisement expenditure carried forward, 60,000 in 2010, 30,000 in 2011. I already wrote off the entire amount. So whatever 48,000 is there, it includes 30,000. So balance prepaid expenses are only 18. Finally, cash and bank balance. Cash and bank balance are 3,000. That's it. Straight here, balance sheet should tell you.